Thank you, Marie.
Everybody knows you now.
Okay, so I come from Aperam Research Center in Isberg, and I will present you some part of the results of Arthur Després, PhD, who was in Vancouver with Chad Sinclair, and Arthur is now in Grenoble CIMAP. And this work was supervised by Chad and my colleague Francis Chassagne. And I will speak about texture formation during the hot rolling of ferritic stainless steels. So a few words about ferritic stainless steel. We've heard different things about austenitic stainless steel this morning, 304 or super austenitic this morning. I will speak about much cheaper stainless steel, because based only on iron chromium system. You see on this chart the relative price of materials, and austenitic stainless steel contain significant or large amount of nickel, which is very expensive, so you can guess the consequence on the total price of the material. As you can see, if the chromium content is high enough, we are fully ferritic at any temperature, except some MX precipitate due to the presence of low amounts of titanium and niobium to precipitate carbon and nitrogen. So due to this BCC structure, whatever the temperature, recrystallization will be the only process to transform the microstructure, refine the microstructure from the coarse as cast structure, as you saw before, etc. And so the final structure, texture, and then properties will strongly depend on this recrystallization process during the production. So we are producing flat products that you can find in these ferritic grades, typically in white goods like these washing machine drums, exhaust systems, and in the cars, the decorative trim, the very shiny, glossy decorative parts you can find in these in your car maybe. So the interest of the austenitic stainless steel is that they have a very high work hardening rate, which give them very high performance in forming, which is not the case in the ferritic, which are BCC. So texture, crystallographic texture controls in two ways, the formability. First, the deep drawability. It's well known that the texture influences the ability to make this deep drawn cup. But also the occurrence of a defect that we call ridging or roping in English, which is an undulation of the strip in the parts that are strained along the rolling direction. And it's a real through thickness process. It's not orange peel, it's not a surface defect. You see here the top surface and the bottom surface, which are heavily correlated. It's really an undulation. And this is due to orientation banding in the microstructure. So very elongated cluster of grains having similar orientations. So this is the sheet plane, rolling direction TD. Banding is coupled with a tendency of out of plane shear. You see here on this picture, it's a section of the Euler space, phi 2 equal 45 degree, where you see superimposed the line, a typical texture of a final product, ferritic stainless steel. And the color code is the shear tendency for tension in the rolling direction. And you see that the maximum of the texture are positioned at in the orientation space at position where you have high shear tendency. So if you combine big cluster of grains and strong shear tendency, these cluster of grains are able to express this shear tendency and create this undulation. You lose the averaging of individual behaviors of grain as you should have in a polycrystal. So where does it come from? Given the size of the length of these grain clusters, it has to deal with the hot rolling, which is the only step which gives such an elongation in the microstructure. And so we have to focus on the what happens during the hot rolling in terms of recrystallization and texture content. So what do we know about textures due to hot rolling? These are experimental results. Only I focus on the mid thickness of the products, avoiding all the story with the shear close to the surfaces. So you saw a nice macrograph of a slab showing the equiaxed region at the center of a slab, and this gives a random texture. But after hot rolling, we end up with such a strong alpha fiber. So the alpha fiber is the one defined by the 110 in the rolling direction, which is not exactly what we obtain if we make some crystal plasticity calculations, starting from equiaxed grain, random initial texture, plane strain compression, where we should have rather a strong gamma fiber, 111, and a weak alpha fiber. These are very interesting orientations for the deep drawability. And if I come back to my previous, so the alpha fiber is here. So in the very high shear tendency region, the gamma fiber is here, where you have an evolution between the different components of the fiber. So the question is, why do we have this this alpha fiber texture, which is not what we expect and not what we would like to have? So the objective of the Arthur PhD was to identify the reason of this texture evolution. And it was done in three main axes. First, working on the deformation texture and focusing on the effect of grain shape. So I advise you to read this nice paper on this part. I will not speak about the modeling and go into detail of this ring deformation things. The second point was to work on the influence of the deformation temperature on the recrystallization. And the point I will present you today is on the modeling of the orientation selection and the texture formation during the recrystallization that occurs between the rolling passes. We have 12 rolling passes during the hot rolling step. And so the final texture should be the result of deformation texture, recrystallization texture, deformation texture, etc. So the experiments were led to on a 20% chromium grade with niobium and titanium. We start from a sample of industrial material. The transfer bar is the intermediate step between the roughing mill, which is a reversible slow rolling, and the finishing mill, which is a continuous tandem mill, 7 stands. So it's the only place where we can cut a part of material, in fact. So that's why we use this one. It's fully recrystallized, 200 micron grain size, and with a quite weak texture, but already with some alpha fiber and also cube, and the maximum at the rotated cube. We performed a lab hot rolling test in a single pass after a reheating at a given temperature, then waiting for the rolling temperature and straining in a single pass. I will present only the 1100 degrees today, but the two reduction. And then water quench, so it's not real static recrystallization directly after the deformation, because it's very difficult to hold the temperature precisely after a lab hot rolling. So then after in furnace, we made some isothermal treatment to look at the recrystallization mechanism. Okay, so let's look at the texture evolution. This is the same as the previous, the initial one. After straining, 50% reduction or 75% reduction, we see this strong development of the alpha fiber. And especially the reinforcement here on the rotated cube orientation. So, and the sharpening of the overall texture. by recrystallization, annealing for fully recrystallized state. We have an overall weakening of the, be careful to the scale, of the texture. And the we end up with some cube fiber orientation and maximum on the alpha, as you can see, especially here in the 112, 110 in the high reduction. So how does it proceed? We have, so this is the rolling direction and the normal direction, the thickness. So we have crushed the grains, which are pancake elongated like this, and we see that we have bulging of subgrains. This was probably a subgrain here, and this red grain, and he grows in the blue, pink, I don't know what is the name of this color. And we have several examples like this where we can see, so it's well known that the at high temperature like this, the ferrite recrystallized by abnormal subgrain growth like this. And we see we have quite few recrystallization sites, and mainly related to grain boundaries between the former grains. We created very few high angle boundaries inside the deformed structure. So if we look at now the orientations and the orientation selection, so it's not random. you see here the number fraction of recrystallized grain per main texture component as a function of the recrystallized fraction. And we can see that since the very beginning of the recrystallization process, we have already done the orientation selection with a dominant cube and a rotated cube orientation compared to the, for example, the blue ones are the gamma grain that we would like to have, which are in a very small number compared to the other one. So oriented nucleation and almost constant fraction. So we try to predict this recrystallization texture coming back to abnormal grain growth models. Considering the evolution of individual crystallite in an average matrix, so the crystallite is characterized by its size, its average misorientation with the matrix, its surface energy and its mobility, of course, and the average environment by the same characteristics, the average of these characteristics. So we can write all the equations for the growth condition of this particular subgrain, taking into account the Zener pressure and the growth the evolution of the average grain size with the same kind of equation. We took properties of the boundaries which are depending on the misorientation as we have the information. And as Mark showed this morning, the abnormal growth criterion is when an individual subgrain is growing faster than the average. So we can compute this relative growth rate as a function of the relative size and the misorientation and create these maps where all the points which are higher than this red line are conditions which should lead to abnormal growth. So if we try to compare this with the vertex model, which was a reference method for simple microstructures, so we create a population of crystallites characterized by their size distribution and property distribution, make it grow, and then we compare the property, the initial properties of what became grains versus this line, critical line that we define. We see that almost all of these grains are in the right area of this diagram. And this is the probability to reach the critical size for all the subgrains which are in a given coordinate. So average misorientation and relative grain size. Well, it's interesting to see that there, of course, the probability increases when we move like this, but that it's significantly high for relative growth rates much higher than zero, of course. That's the not really this border which is important, but some significant growth rate to bring to significant recrystallized fraction. So the growth rate is also important, and we modified this with the time integration, meaning that for each of these subgrain, we calculate the growth rate and we time integrate it. Of course, we have problem of box size, so we have to some of the small grains disappear, or small subgrain disappear, and we suppress also the smallest to keep constant box size, average the size, and then the recrystallized grains are defined based on a critical size which is much higher than the initial subgrain size. And so we have the texture at each step. So again, if we create something, a model microstructure that is close to what we have in our rolled material, we select typical mean orientations. We create some spread in terms of size and orientation inside this band to mimic the deformed structure. And if we make it grow by the vertex, we can see this kind of evolutions. And if we compare what we obtain in terms of texture with the vertex and with our time integrated mean field model, you see that we catch very well the ranking of the different components and even the absolute volume fraction for the different texture components. Of course, it's strictly related to these advantages, as mentioned Mark this morning, the size advantage of the red component, and also the misorientation advantage, which will make them higher driving force and high mobility. So now we applied to experimental microstructure. So we made some large EPSD maps on the deformed microstructure to measure this distribution and identify these parameters, so individual parameters for each subgrain and the averages. We also measured the precipitation state to introduce a reasonable zener pressure. And now let's look at what it gives. So here you have the experimental hot-rolled texture. The experimental texture of the recrystallized fraction for 75% recrystallized, and what is given by the model, which is in this case very close. This graph represents the comparison between the experimental volume fraction of each orientation in the Euler space with a 15 degrees spread versus what is predicted, and the big markers are the precise low index orientations that we're interested in, showing again here the cube orientation, which is the main component. So it works very well for that. We are very happy. It's a bit less nice for the higher reduction, but still we still catch the main feature of this strong alpha and cube orientation, with here two large estimation of the cube, which is here in this this cloud of the cube. But again, it's relatively quite good at giving us the right texture. And these are the experimental distribution which explain this result, because finally our model is simply the transformation, the selection procedure based on these individual properties. And you can see that, so the black line is for the cube orientation, which has in this condition both a size advantage and a misorientation advantage, which is also the case at the 7500. It's less true on the disorientation, misorientation, but very clear on the size advantage. I think I'm on time. Perfect. Great. So conclusion, this is what I didn't show you, but which is in the ACTA paper I mentioned, which is we know that we have a tendency to develop the alpha fiber due to the plane strain compression of our microstructure, and that this is further enhanced by the shape of the grain and the pancake grain. Interpass static recrystallization will proceed by abnormal subgrain growth, and will develop the alpha and cube fibers, which are due both to a size and a misorientation advantage. And this was relatively well captured by our model. And from an industrial point of view, now we understand very well that we can have a positive scenario where we have multiple recrystallization, which each recrystallization, even if it leads to non-very beneficial orientation, it will at each time weaken the texture. It's still alpha, but it's weak alpha, and it's equiaxed grain, which will lead to less alpha grains during the rolling. Whereas if you have few recrystallization, you will end up with very sharp alpha texture and elongated grain, which further strengthen the alpha fiber, and then you go to the bad scenario, sharpening strongly the alpha fiber. Okay, thank you for your attention.